Hi, welcome to the third video in the Leonardo da Vinci Down the Rabbit Hole series, where we look at more paintings by Leonardo and other artists for 3D clues. By the end of this series, I intend to present enough evidence to show that not only da Vinci, but many other artists were attempting to break the 2D barrier and bring another dimension to their paintings. By this time, most of you are already familiar with the free 3D, also called Crossview, where a person can see two pictures merge into a 3D picture without needing glasses or a viewer. If not, I recommend visiting my Easy to See 3D page at headscapes.com to learn the process. What we look for are two paintings that are not exact copies, but have differences that can be noted upon examination. Most notably, differences that have a correlation or alignment in a 3D view. Now, some paintings may have different backgrounds and colors in the comparisons, but I suspect this was done intentionally to mark and see the differences in 3D. For example, we look at what Salvador Dali did with the paintings that he made in 3D. Born in 1904 and best known for his 1930 painting, The Persistence of Memory. And although he was intrigued with stereoscopic perception most of his life, he didn't attempt 3D paintings until the 1970s. This is according to the website michaelscrogan'swordpress.com. The website also states that Salvador Dali and others used differences in hue, luminance, and contour for an effect known as binocular or retinal rivalry. The differences would cause a lustrous sheen similar to the appearance of silk or velvet. Giambattista della Porta has been credited as the first to describe retinal rivalry in 1593. And a side note here about the eye, and that it is composed mainly of two types of light receptive cells called rods and cones. The rods are used mainly in darkly lit areas and cannot see color. The cones are used in brighter areas, and of those we have three types to see the primary colors of red, green, and blue. And like the TV pixel, these three colors can be mixed to help make the entire range of colors that we normally see. I believe this may be the reason that many color differences between paintings are in the red, blue, or green ranges. Now, a little more of the history of Leonardo. According to Walter Isaacson, author of the book Leonardo da Vinci, in The New Yorker, he says he was illegitimate, gay, left-handed, a vegetarian, easily distracted, and at times heretical or having opinions at odds with what is generally accepted. Unable to attend formal schools of learning due to his illegitimacy, Leonardo did not let this stop him, and he gives credit to nature and experience for his knowledge. He became a seeker of truth and used the scientific method to test the world around him. He didn't just accept the wisdom that was being passed down, but he compared it to experiments to find out which parts were accurate and which were more of an old wives' tale. Like the idea that was prevalent in his time that garlic takes away the power of a magnet. Oh, and by the way, Da Vinci was using scientific method 100 years before Galileo was thought to have created it. And even though Leonardo found many walls in his quest for knowledge, he didn't let anything stop his curious mind. Even if his performing autopsies to understand the human body was looked down upon by the church, he wanted to understand the way the world worked. For example, it was commonly believed the world was flat at this time, yet we see Leonardo's notes are full of planetary bodies. And with the backward writing, it is possible that it helped hide his heretic views of the world, like his view on geology. After discoveries of seashells in the mountains, he began to question the church's view on the history of the world. And he shares this in his backward written notes, saying, "Therefore, slow and relentless natural processes, not the divine instantaneous act described in Genesis, have helped shape our planet." Okay, let's look at the timeline of Leonardo's paintings to see how far back we find hints of 3D. But note, the timeline is subjective as we find many researchers show different results. In Wikipedia, we find two paintings of St. John the Baptist, one painting by Leonardo and another by a student, Salai. Then I came across this one that is similar to Salai, but it also has a cross that he points to. So I paired these two together. Then I found a drawing by Giovanni Battista, and as you see, the finger is pointing in a completely different direction and angle. That is, until you combine the paintings and cross, and then we see the whole thing comes together to show depth. Next, we look at the Virgin and Child with St. Anne, and I came across 7 copies, with most found in museums. And here are the best comparisons and pairings I found. First is the Louvre and Hammer version. Note how the mountains and tree in the upper right align. Also, compare the feet below and the cracks in the rocks underneath them, and see how they come together in cross. Second is the Uffizi and the Prado comparison. Again, we find the feet align as well as see parallax with the Virgin's hands. And the Child's hands holding the lamb's ear are again different, but come together in crossview. Next in the timeline is the Madonna of the Yarnwinder in 1510. Now, we have already gone over these in the previous episode, but I would like to revisit the Scottish and Chicago copies for an in-depth comparison to show the differences and how they align so perfectly in cross. First, take a look at the mountain pass leading to the bridge and note the differences. And then below, if we look at the bricks they sit upon, you can see differences in the spacing of the cracks, but when viewed in cross, they will align and come together. And I want to give this the same treatment we gave to the Virgin of the Rocks with the green and red on a black background. This way, we can compare the angles of the yarn winder the baby is holding, the mountain pass, and more. And then, when we overlap the colors, you get to see the differences between the paintings. And then we have the Leda and the Swan paintings. And although the originals by Leonardo have been lost or destroyed through time, we have some preparatory drawings by him, as well as copies by students or followers. And according to Wikipedia, he made 2 different paintings, with one having Leda kneeling and another with her standing. Here we will look at the standing version, as we have reference with another drawing by Raphael. The best comparison is the Spiridon and the Philadelphia. Note in flip the differences of the feet of Leda and the right wing of the Swan. And then in cross, we see the angles in the feet come together, as well as the large and small curves in the Swan's wing. Also, look at the eggshells and notice the edge differences will also come together and give us a feeling of depth. Okay, now I want to look at another 2 painters really quick, as I have a great surprise just recently uncovered that I want to share with you as well. As some of you are aware, in stereoscopic pictures, some people will put dots underneath their pictures to help a person overlap and align the images. So I believe that is what Titian is doing in these paintings of the penitent Magdalene. The Dorotheum Auction House on their website states Titian made many versions with 2 basic types. The first series was of nudes, and in the second, she has clothing on. And there are also subsets within each version. We will look at the skull versions found in the Hermitage Museum and the Dorotheum Auction House. Notice the differences in the bottle to the left. The skull is turned more in one painting, and the book page is fluttering in the air. As you can see, the top page is angled more in one compared to the other painting. Also, note the differences in her hair across her chest, and yet in crossview, they come together with the curls from each painting aligning perfectly. The next artist is Parma Giannino's and his painting, The Vision of St. Jerome, with one found at the National Gallery in London and a second in the Bid to Art website stating it is not believed to be an original. First, we can note the differences of St. Jerome, the pointing finger, the feet, and the angle of his torso, and the big spatial differences between Madonna and Child in relation to St. Jerome, as well as the differences in the old man lying down on the right. And yet, with all these differences, we can see the majority of them come together in a line and cross. The only big difference that doesn't fit is the old man's head. But if you slowly uncross and then bring the images back together, you can see the top arm of the small man matches the chest line of the big man. But still, with that difference, we can see the old man's robe and legs will align and match up in crossview. So far, I have found over 37 artists that show signs of copies made with differences that align into a 3D view. I still have many more Da Vinci paintings, like what I believe to be the real Salvador Mundis, coming in a following video in the series. Also, I will show you how this whole thing started. I haven't yet had time to acknowledge them, as it will probably take the majority of one of the videos, if not individual videos for each person. But all in due time. Now, I want to share with you my easy to see 3D flagship viewer that you can learn and teach others how to see free 3D in 2 to 3 easy steps. In the first step, you have the shell and the mini viewer together for easy viewing with ghostly images removed. Second step is with the mini viewer alone, you can view and note the ghostly images, as this is what you will see when cross viewing without using any device at all to see 3D. Step 3 is optional. Here, you can use the shell alone to help point your eyes to the right picture. Then simply cross the pictures together until you see only one image. As said, this is optional and can be done without the shell. A good way to start is with the picture about 2 to 3 feet away. Place the finger up about 10 inches away from your face and focus on the finger. You should then see 3 pictures behind the finger instead of 2. And then you may notice the one in the middle is now in 3D. And if you have access to a 3D printer, you can download the files to make your own easy to see 3D viewer on Thingiverse for free. The only thing you will have to purchase are prism lenses with the links given in the description. Okay, now for the big surprise. What if we could look at a 3D pair of a painting that most, including myself, would think impossible? I'm talking about Leonardo da Vinci's Last Supper, a life-size fresco painted on a wall in a church in Milan, Italy, with deterioration over time so bad that it is estimated that only 20% of the original is still there. This is according to the DW documentary, What Did Leonardo da Vinci's Last Supper Really Look Like? We follow professor and National Geographic author Jean-Pierre Hiswoods as he investigates and finds evidence that French King Louis XII requested in a letter to commission Leonardo. And it is assumed the king would like Leonardo to make a copy of the Last Supper on canvas, since the king tried to take down the wall with the original fresco in order to transport back to his castle. And in their search, they find not only one copy, but they uncover a second copy of the Last Supper made by a student of Leonardo. The documentary also supports and shows evidence for the copies of paintings we have already covered in the series. The only difference is that they claim the second copies are from different pupils or students, but yet still under the supervision of Leonardo. So, 2 life-size copies of the Last Supper. One found in the Tongerlo Abbey in Belgium, and the other in the Royal Academy of Arts in London. When we compare the two in flip style, we see a number of parallax differences. And with the lines on the floor, I was able to create pyramids to show the vanishing point, and also to compare and cross and overlapping to show small differences. Now, let's do a close-up and pan across the paintings to see how these differences now line up and give the picture depth. Starting on the left, we have the windows slightly off from the apostles' heads and bodies. Also, on the table, the salt shaker and the bread next to it have different spacing as well. Under the table, we can see the foot near the second line on the floor and the changes from one painting to the other. Then, looking at the middle, we can see Jesus and St. John height changes, and how the changes are opposite. St. John goes from low to high, while Jesus goes from high to low. Also, we can note the blue part of the robe of Jesus changes angles as well. Next to Jesus on the right, we see the finger pointer, and the space differences from the window behind him. And then, on the far right, we can see the man with arms extended have different angles. And the windows behind look completely off, but yet in cross, all it takes is a small left tilt of the head to align 2 of the 3 windows, but yet I believe this is an error made in the paintings. So there you have it, Leonardo da Vinci connected to one painting, and one or more of his students connected to the other. Also in the video, we see Ross King, author of the book Leonardo and the Last Supper, talk about how Leonardo wanted to leave a legacy. A work of fame. What if this is a part of his lost legacy? Like the fragments left of the original Lost Supper, we have only small parts of the puzzle showing us the full scope of Leonardo da Vinci. And yet, even with the fragments we have, we can still see that Leonardo da Vinci was ahead of his time. So could it be possible that with his knowledge and experience, he had found the answer to the flatness of painting, and how to bring realistic perception onto canvas? And with such accuracy as to only make differences that can be seen in Crossview? Is it possible he left hidden pictures and possible messages for us to discover, like we see with the hidden bird in the Virgin of the Rocks? As for this facet, I have only begun to scratch the surface after investigating into Henry Lincoln and finally watching the movie, The Da Vinci Code. Okay, I have to stop here or I'll just keep going on. As I said, I have found over 37 artists so far. And the more I learn of Leonardo, the more I am amazed and keep falling down the rabbit hole. Till next time, you can join me on Patreon for a more in-depth look at different versions and comparisons we didn't have time to go over. And don't forget, keep your mind open and keep searching for the truth.